I will show you the top 5 features in the latest update of Power BI, March 2019. Today, we're going to cover the top 5 features. We have a few honorable mentions, so make sure you watch all the way till the end. And we also have a not top 5. If there is a feature that you would like to see in Power BI, make sure to post them in the comments below so we can all vote for those. And anytime during this video, you can click in the corner or down in the description to access the complete update playlist and catch up on all the recent Power BI updates. My name is Avi Singh. I'm a Microsoft MVP and best-selling Power BI author. And if you want to become a Power BI pro, make sure to subscribe and click that bell so you're notified whenever I go live to answer your Power BI questions. Let's start at the not top 5. Now, this is show dates as a hierarchy. So, hey, I don't want to take anything away from the Power BI team. Now, this is a pretty cool feature if you're a newbie and you want to stay that way. But my friend, so let me show you kind of what it is. So basically what it lets you do is, and you would see there are other features in Power BI which try to automatically handle your date field. Don't let it do that. It's okay to create hierarchies, but you should be creating your own hierarchies and you should be handling your own date table using your own calendar table. It all boils down to a choice. A choice whether you're okay with kind of somebody else controlling your life and your models. All right, I speak in jest. Or you want to have total control over your model. And that's why you should look at the ultimate calendar table and this approach. This gives you total control versus Power BI deciding what's best and how you're going to be using date fields. So again, a great feature, but good for rookies if you are stepping into Power BI and want to go beyond just a beginner. I would highly recommend getting the ultimate calendar table. So you can find that on my channel along with all the goodies that are right at the top. So go ahead and click there. We'll also put a link in the corner and down in the description. So let's get started with our top 5 features. Number 5 is selection pane improvements. Let's take a look. So the way to turn on your selection pane, if you don't see that, is to go, and I always forget, it's in the view, selection pane right there. So you turn that on, and if you have never played with this before, there is an idea of selection pane in Excel and PowerPoint as well, and can be really useful. So what you see here is all these different elements. Now, I'll call out some of the important features here, which are new. One of them is just being able to double click and rename. Can you right click and rename too? Well, I don't know. All right. So notice here where I have a lot of card fields and I can't differentiate which one is which. And sometimes, and this selection pane, by the way, I mostly find myself using when I'm using bookmarks. So that is a pretty cool feature in Power BI. So normally when I'm using bookmarks, I would like to know which one do I need to turn on, which one do I need to turn off. And that's where naming them correctly can be really super easy. And that's this feature makes it really easy. I can just double click and I say, hey, this is my variance percentage, and go on and rename the other cards in the same manner. You can also control click or shift click. So, you know, kind of if you're used to Microsoft, so this is the shift click, and then I can do control click to select multiple elements so that you're able to toggle them on and off all together. So now I can come back and say, yep, hide the ones that I had selected and so forth. Number 4 is updates to Bing Maps. Now, we've seen a lot of new custom visuals, and of course, there's the other maps visual driven by ArcGIS in Power BI as well. But the Bing Maps hasn't gotten some love. So this is after a while, and this is certainly most welcome. So we have some heat maps and formatting updates. Let's take a look. So first, let's play around. Actually, you know what? I'll cover the formatting updates first. So you can see this is a bubble chart right now. I'm going to get rid of the selection pane over here. And let's go over to the visualization options. And let's see if we can find the ones that I'm looking for. So first of all, you can control the bubble size. So if you go over here, look at bubbles, and you can see the size, and it felt a little bit odd that it starts off at 1, but then I realized, and I'm like, oh, whoa, they're already too big. But you can even go in negative. So notice as I slide this across, it goes to -3, and so yeah, you can get more control over the bubble size. Of course, if you wanted, you could crank it up to something really big as well. So that's number 1. And then the next control over here is, now if you had a mouse with a scroll wheel, zooming in and out is really awesome. But if you don't have that, or certainly perhaps for touch devices, you now have options to add the zoom buttons right here. So I'm going to toggle that on, and you're going to notice what pops up on here once it renders again are these buttons right there, and just making it easy. And again, if you look at the Google Maps or Bing Maps, there are these buttons, I believe, available on the interface. So it just makes the interface a little bit user-friendly. All right, let's move on to the exciting part, which is the heat map. So you see this diagram over here, and again, I have this option off to the side where I can turn this into a heat map. And so I'm going to turn that on, but then also show you. So again, you see how the layout changes, and I can see where my customers are. Yeah, it's just a different view, and again, can be really beautiful and really effective depending on what you're trying to show. And if you expand that, you have more controls over the radius, pixels, and especially the colors that you want to use for your heat map. Number three is a group of reporting updates to slicers, cross highlights, and web URLs. And I know I'm cheating a little bit in top five, but these are really quick updates with big impact and about the same topic. So the first one is the changes to the single select slicer. And again, it's one of those small things with a big impact. So let's change this to a single select first of all. So for that, I'm going to go in settings. And here, if I expand the selection controls, there is a toggle for a single select. And watch what happens to the slicer as I toggle it on. So as I toggle it on, you notice the display changes to show radio buttons. And that makes a lot more sense now when you see it, right? And I'm like, oh, of course, duh. Why didn't we begin with? But that's great. You know, that's where you see the continuous improvement that the Power BI team is making every month, every day. They just keep getting better. How awesome is that? And the next one is the ability to cross highlight by labels. Now, sometimes when you had a graph like this and you wanted to kind of select that, then it was really hard to select, right? So if you had a long tail graph or something like that, but now you can just simply click on the label names to make that selection. So I can come over here and just click on the label here, clothing, and you notice it just selected on clothing. And of course, not the best cross highlighting. Maybe cross filtering would be good, which was a change in the last release. Go check out that video for February 2019. So you can select this axis, and where this can also be useful is if you had something clustered like this. So in June or July, by month, I'm showing by Europe, North America, and Pacific. And I didn't want to select one of these. There was really no way to select all of June, but now there is. Now you can just select again, just down at the label here, and that way you can select June. The next update in this group is the ability to add web URLs for buttons, shapes, and images. Now you already have, if you have a text in here, you can already link that to an HTML link. If you have tables like this, you can already change that in the modeling behavior and change that field to be a web URL. So those things already exist. But what you can do now is, again, go to a button, shape, or image, and shapes, button, shapes, and you see an image right here. Buttons and shapes are right there. If you haven't used them, go check it out. Can be really useful in laying out your report. But I'm going to show you for this image, all you have to do is go to the action portion here. So I'm going to turn on the action that I want some action to be taken. And again, there are these different options. And the new one here is the ability to add a web URL along with the tooltip. We're on to number two. And folks, this is exciting. Big news and no news. The new modeling view is now generally available, but this is something definitely worth calling out. So they have totally revamped the modeling view. So by now, this was in a preview now, but now this is kind of the default view. And again, it's just, frankly, the display looks a little bit squished. The text looks a little bit smaller than before, but still it feels a lot more fluid, first of all, but then it's chock full of features. The first one there is the ability to add multiple layouts. So you see this is now showing all tables, but you have this handy plus button here, and what you can do that using that is to build a simple build multiple layouts. And this can be really handy if you have lots and lots of tables. And you can see it helps you getting started. Drag tables here to add to the layout. So maybe I want to focus on my budget table. So I add budget. And if you notice here, budget table is really only connected to product and calendar. So really, why add the more complexity? So I'm going to give it a good name, budget. And I'm going to say this is calendar and product. Budget, product, and of course, you know the layout, folks. If you've gone through the tutorial, that you should be arranging it this way. Those rules still apply, but again, you can take a subset of that and simplify it. Now, friends, what we really need is not just be able to create this view, but be able to create a perspective so that an end user can connect to that. If you don't know what I'm talking about, check out this feature. So folks, this is what I'm talking about, and we would put a link for this in the corner in the video or in the description down below. And if you believe in this, then go ahead and vote for it. I think this is going to be super cool and such an awesome addition to what we already have in Power BI. And ironically, this feature is available in Power Pivot Perspectives, which is basically carving out your model, not just for visual modeling, but for building reports as well. But again, a really cool feature for the modeling view here. And wait, there's more. So you have the ability to, for one, multi-select items in your field. So let's go over to sales, and I can, let's say, click this, so I can multi-select those and take some action on that. One of those can be to change the display folder. And this is a technique that I've used quite a bit by creating a separate table to house my measures, but you don't need that anymore. And you can basically do a subfolder. I believe you can also do a subfolder by saying, I don't know, like, so these are my time intelligence measures and so forth. For now, I'm just going to stick to this, but I just hit OK or apply, and we'll see how. Oh, yeah, perfect. That already did it. So you can see within the sales table, I can have these display folders. And again, you can nest them, but hey, don't go too crazy. And again, for a large model, and I go crazy on the measures often in a production system. I have hundreds of measures. Seriously, I'm talking about north of 500 plus measures. This gives you a way to organize it, not just for yourself, the author, but for your end users as well. So however you choose to organize them here, that's how anybody else who's building these reports would see them as well. So notice here, they have the sales measure folder. Now, I'm not sure about the ordering, though. It seems it puts the folder in the alphabetical order. I really feel folders should be up top, or maybe it does give you more control in ordering it. Check it out, play with it, and of course, Power BI team is always listening, so go ahead and submit a feedback to them if you need to. So we're ready to move on to our number one, and wait, don't forget the honorable mentions, but before that, my friend, there's one thing that I did want to talk about. Now, a lot of people that I talk to, the students in my class, my followers on YouTube, I'm talking to you, my friend, a lot of people talk about overwhelm, where they're like, oh, there's so much to do, and I don't want you to feel that way. I want you to feel like you are in exactly the place where you need to be. And this has helped me a big deal as well, and all of my followers, that less is more. This idea that you focus on less and less, that gives you the better results. But the key is to focus on that core 20% that's going to give you the 80% of the results. So if you are just getting started with Power BI, I would highly recommend checking out the Power BI tutorial that's going to focus on the core 20%. So now we're ready for our number one. And boy, this is a bit of a surprise. These are new DAX functions, and we don't get this often. And again, that's what I love about Power BI, which is, you know, I talked about less is more. The core is pretty solid. It doesn't change that much. The core concepts are pretty solid, and one of them is DAX. Now, of course, now again, the concepts are still the same, but we do have a few new DAX functions. Again, this is so rare that this was notable, and hence gets our number one rank. Now, what we have here is a bunch of functions and a few changes. So if you have contains string exact, of course, they can help you if you're in a case where you're trying to search for a string. Now, what I would comment about those two is that watch out and be careful. A lot of times it's possible that what you're trying to do with these two functions could be something that needs to be done in query editor. So always understand and realize what goes in the query editor, the kitchen of Power BI. That's where you do mostly the clean shape transform, and what goes goes in DAX, where typically you do math, right? So if it belongs in the query editor, do not do that in DAX. So distinct count no blank is another one, a handy function that is added. And again, you could do that using calculate and distinct count, but this just makes it easy, gives you a shortcut for this. The other two have small changes, but one of them is big. So lookup value has an optional argument to avoid errors, but all without arguments is now, you can use that without arguments. Earlier you couldn't, and that clears like all filters. And again, it's one of those changes which are like, duh, you know, why didn't we all think of it before, right? But clearly the Power BI team did, and they have delivered this. So that's an awesome update for this. And all of this ranks at number one. Let's talk about the honorable mentions. So one here is a great hack regression chart, not because I'm crazy about this visual. Usually, frankly, I less is more, so I try to focus on the standard visuals built into Power BI. But this is notable because of what was announced in the last month's update. And again, you can click on the corner to catch all the monthly update highlights. And this is one of those features. So last month, they announced that they are going towards make it easier, frankly, built in seamless for these apps to have a payment model. And it's all kind of built in seamless. So now the Power BI App Store is similar to how you maybe experience the Apple Store or Google Play Store, where there are a lot of these freemium apps, right? So free, but with paid option in-app purchases, if you will. And CreateHack Regression Chart is just another one which has that option. So I expect that you will see this more and more. Again, for details, watch the last month's February 2019 update and let me know what you feel about this change, what you feel about the direction that this is leading Power BI to. And PDF connector, oh my gosh, connecting, getting data from PDF used to be such a nightmare. Now, connecting to PDF has been possible for a long time, but now they made some changes to improve that. And the next honorable mention is the Q&A. It now can, if you mistype something, it's smarter about that. If there's some ambiguity, if there are like two product tables and you say product, it can ask you about that or help you disambiguate that. So those were our honorable mentions. As always, if there's a Power BI feature that you would like to see, leave that in the comment below so we can all vote for that. And in the corner here on the screen or down in the description below, you would have a link so you can catch up on all the recent monthly updates. Hey, keep watching more videos and keep learning Power BI. But if you did enjoy this video, I would love to hear from you. So leave a comment, like, subscribe, all the good stuff. Power on, my friends.